If 2,000 years ago, we actually met Jesus, I wonder if we could have recognized that he was truly the Son of God. After all, Jesus was as fully human as he was fully divine. He was like us in all things but sin. He would certainly have looked rather like most other first century Jewish men living in Palestine. He would have been bearded. He may have been dark complexioned from so often living out of doors. He most likely was muscular from the years he spent working as a carpenter. Now, he might have been intrigued by his fascinating parables and his great preaching. We would certainly be amazed by his miracles, and we may have even hoped that he would turn out to be the Messiah who would deliver Israel. But would we have ever suspected that he was the only begotten Son of the Father, that he was the Word made flesh, the very incarnation of God? Even his closest disciples often had trouble understanding who Jesus was and what Jesus was all about. They often misunderstood his teaching, and until they experienced the fact of the resurrection, they would not have thought of him as their Lord and their God. Certainly, if we, like them, witnessed the scandal of Good Friday, if we saw Jesus arrested, beaten, tortured, nailed to a cross, and then dead and buried in a tomb, we might perhaps have still believed he had been a prophet. After all, many of the prophets had been persecuted. But like those first disciples, we would hardly have confessed that Jesus was true God from true God. So it was to prepare Peter, James, and John. It was to prepare you and me on this second Sunday of our Lenten journey to face the scandal of the cross, that the Lord was transfigured. On that mountain of awe and mystery, suddenly the Lord's Godhead showed forth in a light that eclipsed the sun, in a light that surpassed every star in the universe. His clothes became dazzling white, an uncreated, super resplendent light, a light such as nothing in this created world could create. Moses and Elijah, representing the law and the prophets, appeared conversing with Jesus. A cloud of wonder, like that terrible cloud of earthquake and thunder that once enveloped Mount Sinai, now overshadowed them on Mount Tabor. And the very voice of Almighty God proclaimed, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Peter, James, and John had experienced a glimpse of God's infinite glory shining through the human form of Jesus. Did that incandescent vision last for an eternity or just for an instant? Coming down from the mountaintop, Jesus charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. The disciples did what they were told, but they kept wondering among themselves what rising from the dead could actually mean. Well, on Easter morning, the disciples of Christ, much to their surprise and amazement, finally learned what rising from the dead did mean. Something happened that was so unexpected, so dramatic, so overwhelming, so convincing, that those fearful disciples became bold apostles because they had seen the risen Christ. Jesus was truly alive. He spoke with them. They touched him. They ate with him. His death had been the death of death. For just as Jesus had given the gift of his atoning death, so now he freely shared the gift of his resurrected life. Because the resurrection was not just something that was to happen only to Jesus, but is also the sure and certain hope of what will happen to all those who believe in him. Jesus shared fully in our human nature. The body that died on the cross was ours. The body that was buried in the tomb was ours. The body that rose up triumphant from the grave was ours. The body that ascended in glory to the Father's right hand is ours. And just as Jesus never ceased being God when he became man, he never ceased being man when he returned to the Father. That was the vision of the transfigured Christ once given to Peter, James, and John on Mount Tabor. That is the encouraging vision given to us on this, the second Sunday of our Lenten journey, here at Mass, together in Peoria, Illinois. Our destiny in Christ is to actually share in heaven, in the eternal glory and bliss of our great God, with no more suffering, no more tears, no more sadness, no more doubt, no more confusion, no more painful separation from those we love that have gone before us. Now, this consoling truth doesn't mean that the crosses we experience in this life are somehow not painfully real. Like Christ our Savior, Christians in the weakness of our humanity will know a portion of suffering in this life. The pain of Christ wasn't just pretend. Jesus himself truly suffered for our salvation. The night before he died for us, in the Garden of Gethsemane, in agony, he actually sweat blood. He fell on his face to the ground and cried out, "My Father, if possible, let this cup pass from me. But not my will, but yours be done." In obedience to his Father's will, nailed to the cross for 3 long hours before the tear-filled eyes of his sorrowing mother, he cried out and gave up his spirit. So with the good example of Jesus and Mary, we should never be ashamed of our own tears. But in the face of whatever crosses God may send us in this passing world, we need always to pray, as in the Lord's Prayer, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven." You know, in a very real sense, the Mass for us should be a kind of Transfiguration. For these privileged moments together, we too exist outside of the ordinary moments of space and time. In this sanctuary, on this symbolic holy mountaintop, we too can be instructed by Moses and Elijah, by the law and the prophets. We too can catch sight of Jesus, our Savior and our High Priest, transfigured in endless glory before our eyes. As we proclaim together the death of the Lord until he comes, we can actually hear the awesome voice of Almighty God proclaiming, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." In our Holy Communion, we can already experience a taste of heaven right here on earth. Like Peter, James, and John, the glory of the resurrection can overshadow the scandal of the cross. On this second Sunday of our Lenten journey, but really every day of our lives, because of Christ, we too can cry out like Peter, "It is good for us to be here."